Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this webinar organized by Gynecological and Reproductive Endocrinology and Metabolism, the new open journal of the International Society of Gynecological Endocrinology. The webinar today will be chaired by Professor Andrea Genazzani. Professor Andrea Genazzani is the president of the International Society of Gynecological Endocrinology. Since 1980, he's full professor of obstetrics and gynecology and has been nominated since then director of the department of several hospitals and universities in Italy. He is also editor-in-chief of Gynecological and Reproductive Endocrinology, GRAM. And so he will be our host today. And Dr. Valentina Bonos, she is the first author of an article recently published on GRAM, and Dr. Bonos works at the Academic Unit of Obstetrics and Gynecology in the University of Torino School of Medicine at the Umberto I Hospital in Turin. Dr. Bonos has been invited speakers in an impressive number of congresses despite her young age, and she also has many articles in peer-reviewed journals. So I leave now the talk to Professor Genazzani.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, thank you and welcome. This is a webinar where we want to present the author of paper published on GRAM, the new open access journal of the Gynecological Endocrinology Society. GRAM means Gynecological and Reproductive Endocrinology and Metabolism. And Valentina Bonos, which is here today with us, she's the first author of a very interesting paper named Cognition and Early Menopause in Breast Cancer Patients, an Update. This paper originates from that unit where Valentina Bonos was working and where the chairperson is Professor Nicoletta Biglia, a very famous team which was in past very close to Professor Piero Sismondi, working on breast cancer. And then I would like that, Valentina, we can have a discussion about it, and I would like to introduce you, and you can start. And please, and then the first question is, why focusing on this topic?
Well,
yes.
The incidence of breast cancer is increasing worldwide among young women. We know that young women have undergone more aggressive treatments since they have tumors with a less favorable prognosis. Treatments may determine in young women a premature menopause, which determines symptoms which are typically more severe in these patients. Main frequently reported symptoms are hot flashes followed by vaginal dryness, but also osteoporosis and cognitive dysfunction are often reported by our patients. Impairment in cognitive function can negatively influence the quality of life of our patients and have also a negative effect on their lives in the family, in the workplace, and in the society. It is reported that up to 75% of breast cancer patients during treatments and 35% after treatments do have cognitive impairment. And the causes are due to many factors. It can be due to the depression and anxiety, which cancer itself leads, or also to adjuvant treatments.
And how are menopause and cognition related? Because you joined these two points.
Yeah. Well, sex hormones do have an important role in brain functions and on the organization and plasticity of synapses. Estrogens, progesterone, and androgens affect neurons, glia, and microglia, in particular in the hippocampus and in the limbic system, where cognition, mood, but also dementia originate. With menopause, with the decline of estrogens, there are changes in the body of the women, in the mood, in the memory, and in cognitive functions too. In particular, estrogen receptor beta played an important role, since it regulates protein expression of genes which are involved in neurological functions, it promotes neurogenesis, modulating stress response, and giving neuroprotection against ischemia and inflammation. Furthermore, it reduces anxiety and depression. In her study, Colleen Mackie underlined that the menopause transition is the period which is more crucial for the brain of women, since 44% of women, healthy women, complain forgetfulness, brain fog, and difficulty in concentrations during this period. Females have an advantage in verbal memory, and this is also explained with the effect that estradiol has on memory in the brain. Verbal fluency is associated in her studies in the changes in estradiol between the follicular and luteal phase of a menstrual cycle. In animal models, estrogens improve synapse formation, act as antioxidants, improving cerebral blood flow, glucose metabolism, and reducing also the deposition of amyloid in the brain, preventing mitochondrial damage. An important role is played by inflammation, which is very important in cognitive changes. In normal conditions, the blood-brain barrier is closed to most immune cells, but with a decrease in estradiol levels, the permeability of the barrier increases. And independently from the levels of estradiol, cytokines are able to degrade the barrier. Alarming data came from the studies of the group of Rocca from the Mayo Clinic of Rochester. Surgical induction of early menopause increases the risk of ischemic stroke, of dementia, and of neurological disorder. And this effect increases as the age of menopausal onset decreases. In the studies of Rocca, both unilateral and also bilateral oophorectomy before menopause increase the risk of cognitive impairment and dementia. Surgical menopause is different from natural menopause, because with bilateral oophorectomy determines an abrupt deficiency of estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone, with a disruption of the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis, which determines an abrupt increase in LH and FSH. And as a consequence, brain lesions and vascular lesions do appear in the brain, in particular plaques, and there is a Lewy bodies deposition. So the hippocampus and the cerebral cortex becomes more sensitive to ischemic injury and are less able to repair after ischemic stress. Furthermore, surgical menopause in animal models determines an hippocampal induction of Alzheimer's disease related proteins and increased amyloidogenesis. Cells are more sensitized to stress, and also oxidative stress and apoptosis are promoted in neurons. In this interesting study, between people from the Religious Order study and the Rush Memory and Aging Project, in one third of the patients, brain autopsies were available, and early age at menopause was associated with increased Alzheimer's disease neuropathology. In particular, neuritic plaques were observed. In this study, from the French three-city study, including more than 4,000 women, not only surgical menopause, but also spontaneous premature ovarian failure before 40 years old was associated with a worse verbal fluency and visual memory deficit.
Yes, then what about breast cancer, early menopause, and cognition?
Well, the term chemophob or chemobrain is referred to complaints of patients who underwent chemotherapy and which refer now in impaired memory, attention, and speech processing or word-finding deficit. The relationship between chemotherapy for breast cancer and cognitive function was firstly studied in around 1990s, showing in different studies a detrimental effect of chemotherapy or cognitive function. And around 2004, many prospective studies were published, and fortunately, only subtle cognitive changes in a limited subset of cognitive domains were found in around 20% of women undergoing chemotherapy. A more recent meta-analysis performed on 17 studies and including more than 800 patients defined cognitive deficits as small in magnitude and limited to the domains of verbal and visuospatial ability. Last generation studies are about MRI, which shows structural and functional differences in between breast cancer patients who underwent chemotherapy and controls. In particular, a reduction in the regional gray matter was observed, and also a decrease in integrity of the white matter. Furthermore, patients who underwent chemotherapy had altered activation patterns, which indicate that patients compensated dysfunction in areas important for a specific task, activating additional brain areas. We performed a study at our institution on 40 women who underwent chemotherapy, and after 6 months of treatments, we observed a significant decline only in the attention subdomain, suggesting that the deficit related to chemotherapy is domain specific. Regarding endocrine therapy, data are contrasting, since some studies, like the team trial, found that tamoxifen had a worse impact on cognitive function compared to aromatase inhibitors. In this long-term study that analyzed endocrine therapy also 1 year after the end of the 5 years of treatment, no detrimental effect was seen both for tamoxifen or aromatase inhibitors on cognitive functions. And a recent meta-analysis on 14 studies compared 900 breast cancer patients under aromatase inhibitors or tamoxifen with similar group of controls. In the endocrine group, only verbal learning and verbal memory were significantly worse, but no differences were observed between tamoxifen and aromatase inhibitors. Adding ovarian function suppression was analyzed by the Kosoff sub-study, and cognitive functions were observed, but the number of people included in the study was very little.
Then, what we can do? What are your conclusion at the end of all this evaluation?
Yes. In this interesting survivorship care guideline by the ASCO Association, it is recommended that we should always ask patients if they are experiencing this type of symptom in order to promptly recognize patients who need a neurocognitive assessment and a specific rehabilitation. Furthermore, we can assess and treat the possible contributing factors. Since we know that memory declines during the menopausal transition, but then appears to rebound during the postmenopausal stage in healthy women, it can be said that memory problems can be related to menopausal symptoms. So treating menopausal symptoms in breast cancer survivors can help in cognition too. For breast cancer patients, hot flashes are one of the most important symptoms. And we know from this Cochrane that in this subpopulation, antidepressants, SSRIs, and SNRIs can be a valid option for hot flashes treatment with using no hormones. In particular, even if only paroxetine is the approved antidepressant for hot flashes, also other SSRIs like the escitalopram or SNRIs like duloxetine are effective, as we investigated in studies at our division, but also other authors performed many studies about that topic. We know that clinical depression is always associated with breast cancer diagnosis, in particular in young women, and that clinical depression is associated with molecules. So treating all flashes with antidepressive can be also a valid option to help improving cognition. Furthermore, we must encourage patients to have like good practice sleeps and habits. And this Cochrane evaluated which are the non-pharmacological interventions for this type of problems in people who underwent systemic cancer treatment. And both cognitive skill practice and cognitive skill training may be useful in improving cognition. In particular, cognitive rehabilitation is important. It consists in a structured task which aim to improve cognition, strengthening neural pathways and compensatory strategies which can help the patients managing or coping with these problems. And there are learning techniques such as mnemonics which can be used.
And what is your conclusion in general on the topic, Valentina?
It is very important that we focus on this problem because many women will have a premature menopause, and many people will have this type of side effects from treatments. And the alarming data from ROCCA on oophorectomy on prior to menopause demonstrates that an abrupt onset of menopause can cause detrimental effect on the central nervous system. And even if no data are conclusive on breast cancer patients, other studies should be done in order to better explore it. So it's something that we always have to keep in mind while visiting patients at our clinics and during the follow-up visit to ask patients because maybe they do not speak about that problematics.
Yes. And then now we will go to the question from the floor. Please, I would like that everybody can send us the question. I would like to thank Hector Rogelio Santana Garcia from Mexico and thank you for his nice words for Graham. And then I would like to start with a question from D. Kini. If there are no estrogen receptor on the breast cancer, can we safely give estrogen replacement therapy?
In theory, no, because the second breast cancer that a woman can have, it can be estrogen receptor positive. So we do not know which type of breast cancer the woman can have while having a recurrence.
In the recurrent case, but that's the question. Okay, then you believe that even though if she estrogen negative, we have also the triple negative tumor for the breast, estrogen administration, you have not indication for?
No, because also from the Stockholm and EDITS and Liberate trial, we do not have safety data enough to suggest a safe HRT in breast cancer patients.
Okay, and then we have now another question. Why the cognition area, then this topic, is so important for the future of young breast cancer patients?
Mainly because breast cancer survival is so good. So people have a long expectancy of life in front of them. If they develop a cancer at 35 years old, they have more than 50 years in front of them, and they have to then come back to their lives, to their families, and it is very important that they keep staying active and like with children and in the workplace.
Then we have a question from Roberto Verdade. Is the cognitive dysfunction limited to the chemotherapy period or the initial menopausal transition, or is it permanent?
Well, studies are very limited and do not explore long-term effects. But in general, a few years after chemotherapy were evaluated in the studies, and it seems to reverse after a period of washout of chemotherapy. So it seems reversible with only little limited to subset deficits that stay.
And we have now another question from an anonymous participant. What do you think it can be done for better helping young women with breast cancer?
Well, I think that actively asking them about that problem and also indicating them solutions like the one we've seen today, it's very important, because often women are more scared from recurrence and do not speak about other problems they may have in their everyday life. So it's very important that we actively focus on the problem.
Thank you. And then a question from Natalie Atalla. Thanks for talk, she said. Testosterone is strongly linked to sleep and cognitive. So supplementation is useful in breast cancer patients?
It can be useful, but until now, only the vaginal administration has been evaluated. So we don't know if systemic therapy with testosterone can be safely used.
Because testosterone can be aromatized to estradiol also. Then I think that systemic treatment can also include an increase in circulating estradiol probably. And then another anonymous participant asked, which is the future direction of research on this topic?
Well, I think it's very important that larger studies should be performed on breast cancer patients, and also, as asked before by the other participant, that long-term evaluation should be included. Until now, we have only little studies which are in conflict between them, and so it's very difficult to have a conclusive message to give you.
Thank you. And another anonymous participant asked, why are data on early surgical menopause so relevant also in the non-oncological gynecological field?
Well, I don't know if only in Italy, but until the publications of the studies of PROCAM, many gynecologists performed simultaneously to an hysterectomy for a benign polyp, like for myomas, also oophorectomy in people before menopause but aged more than 40 years old. So after the publications of PROCAM studies, preserving the ovaries became so important, and I hope that the publication of the study stopped that habit worldwide.
Thank you. And we have a question from James Simon. Hi, James. It's a pleasure to have you with us. He said, breast cancer seems to never be cured. After chemotherapy, and even 10 years after adjuvant treatment, with no evidence of recurrence, can the patient then have estrogen treatment? Probably vaginal estrogen treatment?
Well, it should be always discussed with patients. Also, the last guidelines from St. Gallen panel and also ENACOG bulletin gave us the possibility of discussing this option, in particular vaginal estrogens, with patients which are in good health, and especially after the ending of endocrine therapy. Since we know that in particular with low doses vaginal estrogens, estradiol levels in the circulating in circulation is very low, and that they can be given with safety. But always after explaining well the benefit and risks with the patients, and after having done the first line treatments, which are always non-hormonal lubricants and moisturizers.
Yes, we have another question, which is in another field, but always related to breast cancer. She's from Rosario Rivadeneira. He asks, what is your opinion on when to do prophylactic oophorectomy in BRCA positive patients with history of breast cancer?
In
breast cancer, BRCA
positive patients. Okay.
What do you believe about prophylactic oophorectomy?
Yes. We do many prophylactic oophorectomy for BRCA patients. In LC1, we do it after the completion of childbirth, so which is around 40, 42 years old. And if they had no cancer, we can discuss with them to take HRT until the age of natural menopause, which is around 50 years old. If they had the breast cancer, we do the same, but we cannot give HRT and we do not use it. We try to help them with maybe vaginal estrogens or with antidepressants for host rashes and like the Nosubab or bifosphonates for osteoporosis. So we help them with premature menopause but with non-hormonal options.
And similarly, Claudia Roderi from Argentina, she's asking, which would be the antidepressant of choice in very symptomatic young women patients after chemotherapy and menopause?
Well, in our clinics, we found good results. In particular, with escitalopram, which is also described by literature as the one with the less the inferior number of side effects. And so we started very low doses, like 10 milligrams a day for 2 weeks, and then we arrived to 20 milligrams a day. Then, if the depression is clinical, doses should be discussed also with the psychiatric, because these are doses for hot flashes, but for depression itself, it can also be necessary a higher dose.
Okay, we have also from China, Professor Xianjian Ruan from Beijing, she's with us. She has a very important unit of gynecological endocrinology and a very important service for fertility preservation. And she asked, since chemotherapy leads to early menopause in breast cancer patients, there are many negative effects and obviously there is no effective treatment. Before chemotherapy, some ovarian tissue can be frozen and then transferred back to the body after the treatment of breast cancer. Can all side effects of breast cancer patients be improved? And can this technology can be of so great importance for fertility prevention, fertility maintenance in patients? How did you believe about that one?
Well, in young women, we always discuss about fertility preservation before chemotherapy, and it is important to collaborate with fertility clinics because it should be done in a hurry, that the passage, and we know also that the short increase in hormones in the immediate weeks after the diagnosis in theory does not create problems for breast cancer, and stimulation can be done in that kind of patients with aromatase inhibitors like letrozole, and thus being more sure for that kind of patients. And it's important to discuss it with every young patient, also if they do not have in program a child there immediately, but it's important also at 23 years to think about it.
Absolutely, absolutely. And then we have now another participant with us, which one a very famous actor in the area of breast cancer is Professor Sergio Pecorelli. And Sergio, which is with us, he may give a message. I have a personal experience with estrogen therapy in estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor negative breast cancer in collaboration with Professor Veronesi, 157 patients. Excellent outcome. We never experience any recurrence and great performance status, including cognitive. Then she asked, why are you so negative about estrogen treatment? And I wanted to give my answer. I am absolutely not negative. I'm not negative. And I also believe that in patients who have the triple negative, the estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor negative tumor, we are also using estrogen treatment. But I would like you have your comment, Valentina.
I'm not negative at all, but I live in Italy, and the legal contingency is one of our problems. So we are very scared about it. And since guidelines do not protect us, it's difficult. It may be discussed with patients, but it's a difficult communication.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And this bring, you know, this situation bring to a certain quite type of defensive medicine for the doctor. We have not to do. You are a young person, Valentina. You have to be strong with your ideas and believings. I think if they don't have any estrogen receptor or progesterone receptor on the tumor, we can go on. But now we have also another question from Alexandra Kromova. She asks, is it possible to use vaginal estriol in patients with tamoxifen treatment and aromatase inhibitor treatment? Is it some difference in administration? I think of estriol in comparison to other kind of estrogen.
Yes, estriol is one of the best choices because it has a low potency, and in particular in tamoxifen patients can be given during the treatment. But during aromatase inhibitor treatment, it can be used cautiously because we know that aromatase inhibitors try to deplete our body completely from any circulating estrogen. So it may be better or to switch to tamoxifen to do this kind of treatment, or to wait until the end of aromatase inhibitors treatment to use it.
And we have a comment of D. Keeney. I would like also to answer. He asks, because of the risk of ovarian cancer, would you not agree that bilateral oophorectomy, certainly he speak about BRCA1 and BRCA2 carriers, can be better and follow it by estrogen therapy? Certainly, a series of nice papers have been published on the bilateral oophorectomy in BRCA1 and 2 with high risk also of ovarian cancer, followed by a positive treatment with estrogen and progesterone. Can you make a comment on that?
Well, as I said before, if the woman is healthy, had not had a cancer yet, HRT should always be prescribed if the woman is symptomatic until the age of natural menopause. So until 50 years old, all the studies are very, they do agree, and we can give it. If a person has already had a breast cancer, and in particular hormone receptor positive breast cancer, I think that other solutions should be considered.
Yes, and then now another question concerning another substance. She's from Pilar La Fuente Gonzalez. She asks, what about osfenifen? What is your opinion or experience to treat vulvovaginal atrophy in those women who are free of cancer, and to use osfenifen also in women with breast cancer who suffer from vaginal atrophy?
Well, osfenifen is a good choice, and even if we do not have direct data from breast cancer patients, we have animal and molecular studies, but also clinical study in healthy women showing a breast safety of this product. In the EMA's approval, there is written that we can use it in breast cancer survivors after the completion of treatments, so not during endocrine therapy, and which is a problem because now it lasts 5 years, endocrine therapy, but in some patients with high-risk breast cancer, we can consider it until 10 years. So when can we use it after 10 years? It's a little problem. And I think that studies focusing on the breast cancer population should be done with osfenifen to give us more safety data.
Certainly, it is always the problem. We have never sufficient number of studies, mostly also for the new substances. We have a comment now from one of our officer of the International Society of Gynecology and Endocrinology, which is Professor Martin Birkhauser. Martin, he wrote, in women suffering severely from hot flashes and loss of sexual interest after breast cancer, how do you evaluate the benefits of menopause hormone therapy, better quality of life, against its potential risk of a shortened survival time? It's a difficult question. How in these women who so strongly suffer from estrogen, from steroid deficiency, how we can evaluate the balance between the potential risk of shortened survival time and the totally well-defined better quality of life of these women during
the
time?
To objective these problems, we can also visit the patient and we can do a BVH and BVH vulvar and vaginal evaluation, because there are also objective parameters to evaluate it, and also validated questionnaires can be given to the woman to explore sexualities like FSFI, and other validated questionnaires were used also in some works from our institution. But then to evaluate the risk and benefits, speaking with the woman is the more important thing, because we have to consider how she lives with these symptoms. And it's very important, because if she has no risk of recurrence, but she has a terrible life, she does not sleep, she does not stay anymore, the husband goes away, it's something very important to evaluate. So it's always important to discuss with people. So it's important to have also time to do it, and not to have maybe a follow-up visit every 5 minutes, because it's very important to focus also on all these aspects of the woman. We created a peculiar office, which is a menopause after cancer, which is a space in which a woman can come, and we have much more time than in the only follow-up visits for breast cancer office. So we can discuss about the problematics, visit patient, and also see her again in like after 3 months to see if like with vaginal estrogens or with other suggestions we get them, the solution is better. So it's something important to have a dedicated space to bear with these problems.
Certainly. And also we have now a comment from Claudia Rodari, which starts also from the question put by Professor Juan, concerning the fertility preservation problem in young breast cancer before the beginning of chemotherapy. And Claudia Rodari, she tells, does fertility preservation in young women diagnosed with breast cancer improve their psychological and cognitive status as a vision of the future? I think your answer can be only yes. We have to take care of fertility preservation, for this is important, the banking of ovarian tissue, as Professor Juan is doing in Beijing, and we are also doing in many other places. And speaking also about substances, Claudia, she's asking, what about vaginal treatment with promestrien, considering its minimal systemic absorption?
Well, it can be evaluated, and it can be also prescribed after discussion with the patient. So it's one of the options which can be considered.
Then we have another question now from Manju Navani. In patients with breast cancer 1, BRCA1 or BRCA2, is better younger, is better to remove uterus with ovaries to avoid giving progestogen and then leaving the possibility to treat the woman only with estrogens?
Well, it's one of the possible treatments that guidelines start to consider, but the impact of an hysterectomy, even if performed laparoscopy by laparoscopy, is more strong in terms of possible complications compared to oophorectomy alone. So it can be an option, but at the moment we are performing only bilateral oophorectomy. And another possibility is in young women, it was discussed maybe to start only with bilateral salpingectomy, and then after arriving more close to the age of menopause to consider oophorectomy, but not about HRT administration. It's only something that literature reported for very young women.
Yes, this is a very important point, and that's to do first only salpingectomy, because you have to remember that the origin of that kind of ovarian cancer start from the tubal tissues, not so much from tissue already inside to the ovary. And then we have also now another question from Gabi Kayata, and she asks, what is the best treatment for insomnia in breast cancer survivors on arimidex. As you know, one of the complications of arimidex and similar drugs is sometimes insomnia and some breast and some brain originating symptoms. What is your suggestion for this kind of treatment?
We prescribe escitalopram, but assume it at night because it gives side effects, somnolence. So it can be useful maybe to take the antidepressants at night so that we combine both effects. Then also benzodiazepine can be used, but we let it to the physician that follows the woman to give. And also another option, it's also the pollen extract from which can also have effects which are similar to SSRIs and SNRIs, but in a more natural way. So it depends from the entity of the problem.
Yes, we have also to look to also other kind of treatments for that kind of diseases. And now another general question, because your team has very good experience. You know, when you speak about how to face, how to treat, you were mentioning also how the administration give us the possibility to well organize our offices. And this is something that not only in Italy, I think all over the world, they give us too many patients in too short time, and they don't give us the real time that is needed to discuss with any individual, because the patients are individual who bring that problem of oncological problems in a young woman. She is a total distraction also of her personality, and you have to take care. Then my question on this, did you believe that in our offices we can need also the help of the psychological team to face the curtain, to take care of the treatment of the patient? Or only the gynecologist can be able to manage?
Well, we collaborate with psychologists. We do not have them with us in the office, but in the same hospital, yes, since we are a polyclinic. So we send them to psychological support when needed. And so it's very important to have a collaboration in Italy. This kind of organization of the breast unit include radiotherapists, radiologists, pathologists, but also psychologists and plastic surgeons, because it's very important to think to the woman in a 360 degrees.
Then we have on that point Roberto Verdade. He asking regarding the non-hormonal treatment of vasomotor symptoms, most evidence points in direction of SSRI or SNRIs. Haven't found concrete studies on the use of tricyclic antidepressants, although they have a relevant noradrenergic activity, theoretically good for vasomotor symptoms. Do you have any experience on this medication?
No, we only used SSRIs or SNRIs. We used the anti-epileptic drug gabapentin. We had an experience with it, but tricyclic antidepressants, no, because too many side effects are reported by literature. But it can be that other authors had favorable results.
Okay, then we have no more questions. Then I would like to put you one. You know, I am an old clinician, and then I am from an old generation. We were totally in favor of hormone therapy. Then we had the WHI. It was a terrible nightmare, and then which completely destroyed the confidence of the women and the confidence of the general practitioner around the gynecology facing this treatment. But then at the end, after 20 years, we are coming back again. You know, the pendulum is going in the other side. Again, hormone therapy has been shown to be adequate, efficient, to be safe. Certainly, the problem of breast cancer remains a major problem. But from a huge series of data, it don't seem that breast cancer is induced by hormone therapy. But breast cancer can have an effect on already existing tumor cells, stimulating their proliferation. I would like to close this session, Valentina, with a comment from you on this point. How we can conceive now hormone therapy for the menopause and hormone therapy for the surgical menopause, for the natural menopause, facing the problem of breast carcinogenesis, not so much of the breast, of the diffusion of a breast tumor already existing. What is your believing, being an oncologist working on breast cancer?
Well, I think that HRT is a crucial therapy that we have, and also a key of solution of all our problems for menopause. And so it's very important that we correctly use it in the window of opportunity, which is the one described by the studies of Rocca, which is near to the menopausal age and given always in safety, which means with a prior mammography. And we know that it cannot generate new tumors. It may be only can make growing breast cancer cells. But so if you have a negative mammography and not a particular familial history of breast cancer, it should be used and it must be used, because so many problems can be also caused by menopause, as we have seen from the presentation of today. So I believe in it.
We too. And okay, Valentina, if I don't know, we go back to see our question and answer. If we have any last minute question, we will go at the end of the list. We had a huge series of questions that we have already answered. And then, okay, 1 second, I'm sorry, I will go. Okay. And then, okay, what a question on gabapentin, that also it can be recommended. And okay, okay, one question. One question was, what do we believe about in vitro fertilization or assisted reproductive technologies in a woman who had breast cancer? She survived to breast cancer. She is still in an adequate age to have a spontaneous production of oocyte, but she needs assisted reproductive technology and stimulation. Do you consider that this have any harm or any risk for that patient?
No, I think she can do it if she is healthy and she has no metastatic disease, and that since new drugs have been evaluated for the in vitro fertilization techniques, which can be safe for the patients, such as letrozole, as I said before, to stimulate. And I think that she has no problems, and that I hope also that cryopreservation or fertility techniques have been also offered to her before doing treatments, because we do not know if all the treatments had a negative impact on her fertility.
Thank you. And then I would like to make a comment. We have received from Ricky Polikov a question that I would like to answer. He asked, do you have data assessing cumulative morbidity in estrogen-deficient long-term breast cancer survivors as compared to estrogen-sufficient women? Yes, Dr. Polikov. A lot of data explain and show that long-term estrogen-deficient breast cancer patients, they have an early occurrence of a series of disease, some in the brain. They have higher risk of cognitive dysfunction. They have high risk of Alzheimer's dementia, of vascular dementia. And then also they have a greater vascular mortality in comparison to estrogen-sufficient women. Estrogen-sufficient women, by that estrogen administration, they are protected at endothelial level, at vascular level, in the brain, in the heart, in the vessel, everywhere. And this is one of the major protection that estrogen can do. Then if a woman, she can take estrogen, she's in a healthy condition and so on, this is absolutely protective in general, for not only for the quality of life, but also for the total life duration. But for those unfortunate who can't take it, for the breast cancer survivors, certainly they are survivors of the breast cancer. We can give treating well the breast cancer a longer life to them, but certainly they will face in the last period of their life, they will face condition who are the testimony of the long lacking of estrogen in these female bodies. Okay, Valentina, do you want to tell something to our guest? We are now 160.
Okay. Now, I thank you for the attention, and I hope that the webinar was interesting, and well, to see you soon.
Okay, thank you. And then I thank you very much. And then I invite all of you to stay with us in the future. A reminder that this webinar was organized for GREM, Gynecologic and Reproductive Endocrinology and Metabolism, the new open access of our society, or journal of our society, where we will discuss every month, we will choose one author, and we will have a discussion on his paper and also on the area that he's exploring in gynecologic and endocrinology. Today it was with Valentina Bonus, with breast cancer survivors and with the effect of breast cancer therapies on the brain. Then, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. You will receive soon information who will be the next author who will discuss with us. Thank you, Valentina. Thank you to everybody, and have a good summer in this time of COVID-19. Bye.
Bye.